At least when there's an evil dictator, that human is going to die. But for an AI, there would be no death. It would live forever, and then you'd have an immortal dictator from which we can never escape.
Artificial superintelligence and the singularity. Today we sift through Elon Musk's predictions on the future of AI, the dangers, and much more as he reveals the upcoming transformation of intelligence and the results that follow.
I mean, most of the movies and TV featuring AI, they don't describe it in quite the way it's likely to actually take place. But I think just have to consider, like, even in the benign scenario where AI is much smarter than a person, what do we do? What job do we have?
But what I do see happening is somewhat of a convergence towards intelligence. Tesla, to make full self-driving work, you kind of need baby AGI in the car because you need to understand reality. Human computers, more or less, it looks like a flat line versus time, whereas the digital compute is exponential. At some point, that will also be above 100, meaning more than 99% of all compute will be digital instead of biological. If we're not there already, we will be within a year or two.
So there'll certainly be a lot of job disruption, because what's going to happen is robots will be able to do everything better than us. I mean, all of us.
Everything will be automatic. I mean, there'll be household robots that you can fully talk to as though they're people, that can help you around the house or be a companion or whatever the case may be. There will be humanoid robots throughout, you know, factories, and ours will also be all automatic. And anything that we're intelligence can be applied, even modest intelligence, will be automated. So if you say like 10, 20 years from now.
So over time, I think we'll probably see a closer merger of biological intelligence and digital intelligence. And it's mostly about the bandwidth, the speed of the connection between your brain and your digital extension of yourself, particularly output. A computer can communicate at a trillion bits per second, but your thumb can maybe do, I don't know, 10 bits per second or 100 if you're being generous. So some high bandwidth interface to the brain, I think, will be something that helps achieve a symbiosis between human and machine intelligence and maybe solves the control problem and the usefulness problem.
A high bandwidth interface from cortex to the your sort of computing or AI tertiary layer, which already exists. The constraint on having human interests and machine interests be aligned is the bandwidth, especially the output. With the neural link, you can increase that by a million, probably. I mean, this is obviously in a relatively benign scenario, because there's a question of not just, let's say it's a benign scenario. How do we even appreciate or understand what the computer's doing? How do we go along for the ride? And if we have a better, if we have a brain-machine interface that's, I don't know, a million times faster, then we're more like, we'll go along for the ride a lot better.
This is extremely important. The danger of AI is much greater than the danger of nuclear warheads by a lot. And nobody would suggest that we allow anyone to just build nuclear warheads if they want. That would be insane. And mark my words, AI is far more dangerous than nukes, far. So why do we have no regulatory oversight? This is insane.
Well, I think we are seeing the most disruptive force in history here. You know, where we have for the first time, we will have for the first time something that is smarter than the smartest human. And that, it's hard to say exactly what that moment is, but there will come a point where no job is needed. You can have a job if you want to have a job for sort of personal satisfaction, but the AI will be able to do everything. One of the challenges in the future will be, how do we find meaning in life? If you have a magic genie that can do everything you want. When there's new technology, it tends to usually follow an S-curve. In this case, we're going to be on the exponential portion of the S-curve for a long time. And you'll be able to ask for anything. We won't have universal basic income, we'll have universal high income. So in some sense, it'll be somewhat of a leveler or an equalizer. Because really, I think everyone will have access to this magic genie, and you'll be able to ask any question. It'll certainly be good for education. It'll be the best tutor you could, and the most patient tutor. And there will be no shortage of goods and services. It will be an age of abundance. I think there's also perhaps companionship, which may seem odd, because how can the computer really be your friend? But if you have an AI that has memory, you know, and remembers all of your interactions, and has read you're going to say, like, give it permission to read everything you've ever done. So it really will know you better than anyone, perhaps even yourself. And where you can talk to it every day and those conversations build upon each other, you will actually have a great friend. As long as that friend can stay your friend and not get turned off or something. And like I said, on balance, I think the AI will be a force for good, most likely, but the probability of it going bad is not 0%. So we just need to mitigate the downside potential. The pace of AI is faster than any technology I've seen in history by far. And it seems to be growing in capability by at least fivefold, perhaps tenfold per year. It'll certainly grow by an order of magnitude next year. And government isn't used to moving at that speed. But I think even if there are not firm regulations, even if there isn't an enforcement capability, simply having insight and being able to highlight concerns to the public will be very powerful.
The average person, they don't see killer robots going down the streets. They're like, what are you talking about? Man, we want to make sure we don't have killer robots going down the street. Once they're going down the street, it is too late.
Particularly if it's engaged in recursive self-improvement, if there's some digital superintelligence and its optimization or utility function is something that's detrimental to humanity, then it will have a very bad effect. It could be just something like getting rid of spam email or something, and it's like it concludes, well, the best way to get rid of spam is to get rid of humans, you know. The solution that seems maybe the best one is to have an AI layer. If you think of, like, you've got your limbic system, your cortex, and then a digital layer, sort of a third layer above the cortex, that could work well and symbiotically with you. I mean, just as your cortex works symbiotically with your limbic system, your sort of a third digital layer could work.
The long-term aspiration for Neuralink would be to achieve a symbiosis with artificial intelligence and to achieve a sort of democratization of intelligence such that it is not monopolistically held in a purely digital form by governments and large corporations. Essentially, how do we ensure that the future constitutes the sum of the will of humanity? And so if we have billions of people with the high bandwidth link to the AI extension of themselves, it would actually make everyone hyper smart.
If one company or small group of people manages to develop godlike digital superintelligence, they could take over the world.
I try to convince people to slow down AI, to regulate AI. This was futile. I tried for years.